Hey guys, it's Grandpa Craig here. Welcome to Youth Group. Let's join and sing and have some fun.
There you go. That's right.
Okay, Pouty.
That was terrible.
It's okay. Nobody's watching right now anyway. When they go back to watching,
they'll come back. There's a watch after this. They will join.
I'm going to screen record that later.
Nifty.
Catherine, did you leave? Were you leaving?
I
Just sing.
Yeah, just sing.
Don't matter if you can hear yourself.
Sing the words, but louder.
Check, check, check. Okay, we're back. Trying again. Days of Elijah.
Well, see, this is the one I know better. This would have been better.
Okay.
This one was awkward.
So if we die again, you're on.
Okay, I'm all you. All
right.
Thank you.
come together and we can worship your holy name. I thank you again for these young people that are here tonight, Lord, to hear from you, the living God. Lord, please just anoint Craig now. Fill him with your Holy Spirit, Lord, to lead us and to lead us into your presence, Lord, and to help us to hear from you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Before she heads off to college, and that's the night before Brooke heads off to college.
What night is that?
The 24th.
$1,000 in my account.
You be back yet?
I'll be back, but I don't know if we'll be up here again.
You'll be an old married woman by then.
I know. Got other responsibilities.
Did you mention our guest speaker next week?
Oh, next week we do have a guest speaker.
For 10 or 15 minutes.
For 10 or 15 minutes.
Ooh.
Her name is
Chloe Kramer.
Wait, did she go to our school?
Possibly. She's speaking on life, the sanctity of life. She's coming in doing 10-15 minutes.
She just graduated last year. She always goes to the abortion rallies.
Yes.
Did she just graduate last year?
Yeah, she's only 19.
Yeah, okay.
Her brother.
So that's next week. Awesome. It was awesome. Sorry I couldn't be there, but we had 6 of our youth get baptized this last Sunday. That was awesome. You guys did an awesome job the week before at the youth-led Sunday. You did such an awesome job. A pastor from another church said we could go and do it at his church.
We should. Woo.
Which church?
Me and Christian on announcement.
It's the Henriette Church.
The Henriette Free Methodist Church. Down by Mora, down that way.
Oh, so it's a little bit of a track.
Yeah.
You have to stay the night.
One of our conference ministerial candidates, we have 2. Casey and Matt. Matt's supposed to go down there leading their church, whether their pastor's on a sabbatical or just taking some time off or something. So he's been up here a couple times. So he was here when you guys did your youth led Sunday. You guys did an awesome job, like we expected. So
covered for me, it was good.
Oh yeah, I did.
Yeah, she covered for you.
I had to go. I didn't have a ride, so I don't.
It's okay. It was fine.
My
parade, everything was good.
Well, I would have drove myself, but
sadly, right away in September, guys, we have our Kingdom Youth Conference coming up. Yes. And so that is something to keep in mind if you want to go to. It's right away in September, September 9th, 10th, something like that.
I took it off from working there.
Another thing is, I got to make up my mind in the next day or so about mission trip for next summer.
Far away as possible. The longer the better.
Let's go to, actually I won't be here, but.
Let's go to Mexico.
Wait a second. I'm not sure about that.
You know, I can only take off so much time from work. But, the one I'm leaning towards right now is one day longer than the other one.
Where's that?
It's.
Yeah, is there an air conditioning there? Yeah.
Actually, this one in their brochure says air conditioned sleeping quarters.
What?
Ooh, the one where I go.
That we've not gotten.
Last year, I like that. Broke.
But I've never had this one. There can be up to 440 people at the mission site at one time. And they have 6 female showers and 6 male showers. So it could be a little bit of a time getting through there. I don't know how many people they normally have. It just says that's the capacity.
But where is it at?
That is on the Rosebud Indian Reservation.
What state?
South Dakota.
Oh, South Dakota.
Going there again?
As long as there's a Sonic, I'm fine.
There is nothing around where we're going.
So,
that's why it's so nice, because they have to have it. It's nice.
But I am still leaning on, because we have to stay someplace, I still am leaning on going past where we gotta go and staying in Rapid City for the first night so we can go to the motorcycle church that Sunday. And a possibility because it ends on Saturday, not on Friday, is going back to Rapid City for another night, because if Hills Alive, the Christian music concert is there, we may go back to that. It's all up in the air. And then we'd have just as long a drive coming back as we did going out the first day last year. So we'll have to see about that. We got the second, right after we get back from Kingdom, or from the Kingdom Youth, we have that fall festival on the
Wednesday right after.
The 14th, thank you. I thought it was 15th, but I wasn't sure. So we have the fall festival, you know, with the hay rides, the games outside.
Which we could use a lot of your hands.
We need a lot of help.
I'll go into myself.
Oh yeah, we're going to talk about that. Are you guys interested in doing Mock City again?
Yes, 100%. She invaded my room the other day. I did. That was fun. You had your own room when you
came over. We will try to plan that for an October. October 1st, Saturday, October 1st is out. We did it over in Brainerd one time on October 1st. I remember that. But somebody's getting married that day, not you. Linda.
Oh, yeah, right. She gets married here. Linda, baby.
Yep.
Do you remember? Wait, what's his last name? What?
Von Schlachtenberger or something.
Is that actually?
No,
I have not called her Linda von
Schlachtenberger. Von Mosdam, yeah.
Is he like German or something? Or
I have
Austrian?
No idea.
He's 100%
German.
We're Austrian.
But on the wedding night, it takes time.
Okay.
Yeah, that'll be
we're going to have to get going, even though I'm not, don't have a very long one here. I was hoping to have some more of our seniors here.
Oh, well.
Show up, guys.
Tatum and I are here.
Yep.
No, me and Brooke are both.
And
are we talking about incoming seniors or exiting seniors? I know. Shh. Don't talk about that.
So I had a topic and I was going through it and I asked it, I went back and it's kind of a piece of a couple different ones. But a lot of it has to pertain to everybody. A little bit more maybe to the ones leaving home right now. But are you ready to leave home is what I titled it.
This should be your home.
With your faith. Are you ready with your faith to leave home?
Yes.
Three different studies show, or excuse me, there are three different studies, and some of them show 60 to 70 to 80, even as high as 90% of high school professing Christians lose their faith in college. 66% of Christian kids walk away from their faith is what another study says, according to Lifeway Research. Barner Research says 70. Says being religious is no longer a trend for teens, research shows. Says the decline in religion among teens is staggering. 29% among eighth graders, 35% among high school sophomores, and 27% more lose their faith as seniors. I said the only way to protect your faith is to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Being religious doesn't cut it. A young lady here a few years ago, I asked her, what do you want to get out of youth group? I want to be more religious, is what she said. I think I knew what she was meaning, but that was her terminology. And people with very, very strong backgrounds can struggle desperately when they leave home. And this really had nothing to do quite so much with my lesson, but I saw it and I thought maybe it would resonate with some of you. Pinky, can you show that video? You guys all know who Michael Douglas is?
Yeah.
He's a Christian recording artist.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. I don't usually work
the recorder. Hold on 2 seconds. I'll be right back.
Anybody ever hear any of the I Am Second videos?
There's so many things I love about my life, and music is one of those. That's what I do as a job. I don't wake up every day and think, man, I got a musical career, and I'm going to go make a record today. But I just as much enjoy just loving on people. I love when I get into a youth group, and I love finding the underdog. I love finding the kid in the corner that you know is the outcast, and I love going up to that kid and put my arm around that kid. I can do stuff like that for the rest of my life and not sing another song. Grew up playing drums, wrote my first song when I was 5 years old. Was able to hear a pop song and be able to play it. And I was in the choir in a little Baptist church, and my heart was really after the Lord. All I wanted to do was just pick up a guitar and sing praise songs. God had a call in my life, and music was supposed to be a part of that. For some reason, it was contagious to me. It made me light up. It was a beautiful time of my life. It sort of anchored me. I felt like I was riding a wave that really was something very, very pure. And it really penetrated to my heart. This is just what I'm supposed to do with my life. Well, when I got to 17, all my older friends went off to college. And I moved to Nashville, Tennessee, to be a songwriter. I was playing in after hours bars from 1:30 to 5:30, just in a bunch of trouble. And I began to be enticed that maybe you can play with a fire, you won't get burned. Little did I know that I would be in the biggest pit of my life and feeling like there was no way of escape. Smoking that first joint and feeling so guilty about it. From there it went to, you know, it was cocaine, it was LSD. And I'm just in the thick of it, man. I'm just doing this stuff and I got sucked into this thing. For some reason I justified it. You lose perspective. It's almost like your compass sort of just like disappears and you enter this whole other world. And you don't really realize it's going down, and then all of a sudden it's too late. You know, I flashback of those times when I was 15 going, just really hearing the voice of God going, I've got a call on your life. I knew where I belonged. I just couldn't get out of the mess that I was in. And I was very depressed. That went on for 3 years until I had near-death experience. And snorting something that you thought was cocaine and it was something else. Thought I was going to die. Literally thought I'm dying. And that's when I began to pray that God would do whatever he had to do to get my attention. I need to be rescued. I got rescued at 12:30 at night on the linoleum floor of my kitchen right outside of Nashville. I went on the floor and just began to shake. And I was crawled up like a baby, you know. I was just weeping. And I wept and I wept and I cried and I cried. I just began to cry out for God. The God of the universe came and wept with me on that floor, and I haven't been the same since. It all changed. I made up my mind that I would hold myself accountable. I would surround myself with great people. And one thing led to another. 8 months later, I got my first songwriting contract. I was getting paid $200 a week to write songs. I thought I'd die and gone to heaven. Then all of a sudden, I found myself getting a record deal. And I'm in the studio 14 hours a day, and I'm writing songs. And, you know, all of a sudden, I'm opening up for Amy Grant. I'm doing my own tours. And then all of a sudden, you found yourself filling arenas. I never could have orchestrated any of this. So been pretty remarkable. God's faithful. I know now what the real deal is, and I know now that selling millions of records doesn't bring me peace, and I know where my hope lies. It's not being a rock star. All that stuff dissipates, man. It never lasts. It doesn't last. The greatest peace that I have is I know who I am. I'm a son of the High King of the Universe. My identity crisis is solved. I am Michael W. Smith, and I am Seth.
I heard that the other day on the way to work, and I thought, you know, that talks a lot about what a lot of our youth go through. They might have it all together when we're all here together, youth group. But they get off on their own, and life happens. And to let it know that, I don't know, how many of you know who Michael W. Smith is?
I do now.
He's
a recording artist. He was big when I was young, up until even just a few years ago, he was still doing a lot of stuff. And he you know, he had to connect back with God to get his life in order. And then the thing with, is Christianity a religion or relationship? That kept popping into my mind this week. And it says, comparing the difference between religion versus relationship with God. As believers, if we are not careful, we can easily be involved in religion and be oblivious to it. Religion can easily dominate our prayer life. Religion can easily dominate your daily walk with Christ. Religion can cripple your relationship with God, and it greatly hinders us. A lot of you are wondering, what is he talking about? However, believers can go overboard when they use the religion excuse to live in rebellion and worldlessness. Now I looked up some quotes, and I wish Belle and Izzy were here because there's one of theirs in here. This first one says, a lot of people think Christianity is doing all the righteous things you hate and avoiding all the wicked things you love in order to go to heaven. Now that's a lot of men with religion. A Christian is a person whose heart has been changed and they have a new affection. And I always thought about religion versus relationship is, when I was a kid, we were in church every time the doors were open. And it was almost like you had to be there. But there was people that when they got there, they made it known that they were there. We were just always there. The people that make it known that they're there, or we have to be there all the time, compared to I want to be there all the time. When you want to be there all the time, when you want to go and worship, when you want to come to church because you look forward to it, that's what makes you go on to the next week. That's a relationship. I know a man, we're doing communion in our old church. His wife was in labor, but he wouldn't leave because he wanted everybody to show, it was a show for him. And here's his wife in labor, in the back, but he wouldn't leave until church was over. And to me, that's more show than practicality or a relationship. If you have a relationship with Jesus, he wants you to help others, whether it's your spouse that's pregnant, or anything else. Here's the one that, here's one from A.W. Tozer. Most men need to play a religion as they play games. Religion itself being, of all the games, the one most universally played. A.W. Tozer. A.W. Tozer, he's written a lot of books, and he was an evangelist, was he? Well, Pastor Jim quotes A.W. Tozer a lot.
Yeah.
Here's the one that Bella's used on me. Religion is a guy in church thinking about fishing. A relationship is a guy fishing thinking about God. I don't know if I buy that quite so much, but Izzy told Bell that one. Bell told me that about deer hunting.
There's that sign, Bella Reduce Fish House.
What's that?
Bill Redoux has that sign in his fish house. That's those exact things.
It says, is Christianity a religion? Many people like saying things like Christianity is not a religion, it's a relationship. This is true, but it's not entirely the truth. The problem is, find the place here again. that I see many Christian circles is that many people use the grace of God to indulge in sin. They say things like relationship over religion or Jesus over religion, but they forget such things as repentance and sanctification. When I think of repentance, I always think of the lady that was accused of having all the husbands and everybody's there to stone her. And, you know, Jesus says, the one without sin, throw the first stone. Well, a lot of people like to use that line. The one without sin, throw the first stone. But the repentance comes in a few lines later when Jesus says, go and sin no more. You can't just keep doing the same thing over and over and over again, knowing that it's sin. You need your repentance. It says, however, evidence of your life in Christ is that your life will change. And Christ will change your world. I heard someone say, Jesus hates religion. That's not true. Jesus hates hypocrites. False religions. And he hates when people try to appear religious to show off. However, in John 14:23, Jesus says, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. As believers, we obey not to maintain salvation. We obey out of love, gratitude, and when you have a true religion, you don't see it as a religion. You don't try acting like something you're not. You act the way in which a new creation should act. There's a commentary out there in James 1:26, the commentary says, true religion teaches us everything as in the presence of God. And James 1:26 says, those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep the tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. James 1:27 says, religion that God and Father accepts is pure and faultless. Is this to look after the orphans, widows, and the distressed, and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world? I was thinking about that, polluted by the world. Pastor Jim gave the statistics, we've given them to you, about a worldly view and how many pastors don't have a biblical worldview. And going off in life, if you don't have that biblical worldview, you're not going to look any different than the rest of the world. You guys know who Billy Graham is? I was lucky I got to see Billy Graham probably 5 times. Our old church used to take bus down all the times, and he had crusades down at the state fair. And I saw him twice at the old Hubert H. Humphrey Dome. There's another person has the quote that says something about go through life with the Bible in one hand and a newspaper in the other. And a lot of people put that back on Billy Graham, but somebody else said that Billy Graham's quote was, what a moment to take the newspaper in one hand and the Bible in the other and watch the unfolding of the great drama of the ages. This is an exciting and thrilling time to be alive. I would not want to live in any other period. Well, newspaper, especially for you guys, are probably something you don't read very much. But you read a lot on the internet, I'm guessing. Watch a lot of things on TV, hear it on the radio. So everything that you want to dissect, dissect it with the Bible. Compare it with the Bible. And I got thinking again about our seniors leaving, and I said, remember, the devil sees you when you're vulnerable, and he tries every trick he can on you. And I did write this down, but I was looking through a thing about being vulnerable, and it was about Joseph. And it gave seven things that made Joseph vulnerable. One was being young. One was being good looking. One was having somebody tempt him over and over and over again. One was having nobody to be accountable to. I can't remember what the rest of them were, but there were seven of them. And I thought, you know, that really, really, really sticks out. Especially when you go away, because you probably don't have anybody to be accountable to. At least not right there. And being young, you know, like it says in Timothy, don't let anybody look down on you because you're young. But also being young is you don't have the life experiences, and people try to take advantage of that. Then I thought, you know, especially with everything going on in our world right now, especially this year, especially in Minnesota with all our elections coming up, you're going to be bombarded with a non-biblical worldview. And I got, you know, in order to be able to fend that off, you have to have that biblical worldview, and you have to believe that the whole Bible is true, not just part of it. What's the first verse most of you learned in the Bible?
John 3:16.
Okay. So John 3:16. Do you believe that one?
Yes.
Well, there's some very obscure verses in the Bible that people say, well, what about this one here? Well, if this one over here that's a very obscure verse in the Bible is, you can't believe that one, then you can't believe any of it. So you have to believe all the Bible is true. And I've told you this before, believing all the Bible is true will make people hate you. Like I've told you, I'm not welcome at my sister's house anymore because my wife put a post on the internet that says you either believe all the Bible or none of it. Well, that made us hateful, homophobes, hate women. We've been told a lot of things because we believe the Bible is true. Someone want to read 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17?
I'm close to that.
John.
Yeah, I copied. Would you copy? Yeah. What was it again?
2 Timothy 3:16 and 17.
Wait, this is
Are you one?
I have this. Okay, go ahead.
It's loading.
It's on his phone. He doesn't get
it. Okay. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness.
17.
Are you going to be going or?
Oh, he only has 16 on it. Oh, I got it.
Keep going. He needs the next one.
The man of God may be complete throughout, thoroughly equipped with. That the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work.
So there it says the whole Bible is God breathed. All scripture is God-breathed and useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. Believing the Bible is true and having a biblical worldview, you're probably going to be called hateful, homophobe, anti-woman, and so on. Anybody notice? Can somebody read Isaiah?
I gotta find it.
5:20.
It's just easier. You go like this in this one.
Where are we going?
Isaiah 5.
I'm gonna make it this time, guys.
I got it.
Woe to those who put evil for good and good for evil. Does that sound like any time in our life, like right now?
Yeah. Yes.
A lot of evil is called good. And a lot of good, they're calling it evil. People who call the truth hate the truth. It's one of my favorite quotes that I heard Pastor Jim say. People who call the truth hate the truth. What's the truth?
The truth is something that's not,
Who's the truth?
God. Jesus,
I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. A biggie that you're going to get hit with, and you see it all the time, is soji. Anybody know what soji is?
No idea.
Sexual orientation and gender identity.
Oh, wow. That's
a new acronym for me.
We explain.
Listen to the Supreme Court butcher or the radio. It's called soji laws.
That sounds kind of gross, honestly.
Soji.
I don't like it. Sounds like a
technical. Just plain and simple. Homosexuality is a sin.
Yes.
And in Leviticus 18:22, it says, do not have sexual relationship with men as one does with women. That is detestable. And in Leviticus 20:13, it even goes into more detail on that. But that's what one reason that I am called hateful is because I believe the Bible is true and I have relatives in that lifestyle. I still love them to death, and I would do anything for them. Do I support their lifestyle? No. If they ask me, I will tell them. But I'm not going to go say bad things about them. I'm not going to go try to hurt them. I know that it's wrong, and being as I believe that it's wrong, I'm a hateful person. I've never done anything to tell them that I dislike them for that because I wouldn't tell them. So, as Christians, and this is, to me, I got looking at some of the old news articles and stuff like that, between religion and a relationship. A lot of churches or people have done a lot of bad things in the name of religion. But every one of them people, no matter what they've done, murders, everybody is made in God's image. And we are to love them. It does not say that we are supposed to support them and we are supposed to believe what they believe, but we're still supposed to love them and treat them with kindness. I saw a picture on that today, and I wish I would have kept it. It was kind of a neat picture, and I can't even remember exactly what it was, but then a lot of people will tell you that, well, Jesus hung around with sinners, and even says in the song, Jesus, friend of sinners. Everybody that Jesus, look through the Bible, anybody that Jesus had contact with who was not a follower of him and was caught up in sin became a believer when he talked to them. But Jesus had his core disciples that he hung around. That's who he spent his time with. People he was training and people that he could trust. And that's where a lot of young people, I think, mess up, in my opinion, is because they hang around people that will bring them down instead of hanging around people that will bring them up. Another big one that's going to get hit, especially people that just turned 18, you're going to vote this fall, and you're going to get hit on, and it's going to be, the ads are going to be awful coming up in the next month or so, is the abortion. Someone want to read Psalms 139, 13 or 14, right in the middle of the Bible.
Being, you knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well.
For you are created in the inmost being, and he knew you when you were in your mother's womb. Someone want to go to Exodus?
Exodus 13.
That's one of the Ten Commandments.
I wrote a paper on this.
Did
you? Anti-abortion. I wrote a
paper
on
getting
back.
Well, some translations of the Bible say do not kill. And this translation says you shall not murder. Some say thou shalt not murder. But if you look back at the original text, the word they use is basically take innocent life. Because the Bible is a lot of killing in there, and a lot of it is sanctioned killing. But you shall not take innocent life. Well, there's no more innocent life than an unborn baby. You know if they have a crew chapter up at Crookston?
A what?
Crew?
What's that?
Crew used to stand, it used to be called Campus Crusade for Christ.
Oh,
now it's just called Crew. And there are crew chapters at most colleges.
So maybe.
Who went to Pillager for kindergarten?
What?
Did you have Mrs. Fredman?
No, I was Pettit.
Did you?
Yeah, my mom was my teacher.
My son had a crush on Mrs. Pettit before she was Mrs.
I
Pettit.
I see why.
Okay.
She's a sweetheart.
Before she was Mrs. Pettit, then she was dating Mr. Pettit, and they saw each other at Hardee's, I think it was, and he was so mad because she wasn't old enough to be dating somebody like that. That was his kindergarten teacher, you know?
Oh, no.
Oh, my goodness.
You know who Mrs. Fredman is, though, right?
Yeah.
Mrs. Fredman has a daughter named Amy. Amy went to school in Eau Claire, and I'd love to have Amy come talk to us sometime. Amy went to work with Crew after she graduated. But Crew, being in leadership in Crew, is like being a missionary. You have to raise your own support. So we supported Amy for years and years and years. Now she moved back to Minneapolis and she's moving up in the organization. But if you go to college and they have a Crew chapter, get yourself involved. It's kind of like a college age youth group. You go to CLC, Bay Ministries has, you know, things at CLC. Get yourself involved so you're around people that think more like what you should be thinking. And I messaged Jess, I think it was yesterday, about a song that kept popping into my head. This song was written in 1972, and I was in youth group in 1977. And it was one we sang in youth group when I was in youth group. And it has a lot of times when I'm struggling with something in life, I think of verses from this song. It's called Through It All. Anybody ever hear that one?
Maybe. Sing it for us.
Yeah, I'm not
singing. I didn't hear a couple.
Yeah, I
Jess?
Jess?
Jess, you sing.
Well, okay.
Oh, he has it.
I don't know. Oh, you got it. I'm like, I don't know if I know the words.
Yeah, just Craig, why don't you just read it to him? This is the words.
I don't know if I can even think of the tune. I need the hymnal.
Okay, see, Craig, you know it.
He's going to sing for us.
No, I'm not.
Okay, just read it for us then.
It says, I've had many tears and sorrows. I've had questions for tomorrows. There's been times I didn't know right from wrong. But in every situation, God gave me blessed consolation that my trials come to only make me strong. And this is through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus, I've learned to trust in God, through it all, I've learned to depend upon His Word. I've been in lots of places, I've seen lots of faces, there's been times I felt so all alone, but in all my lonely hours, yes, those precious lonely hours, Jesus let me know that I was His own. And then it goes through it all. And then that says, I've learned to depend upon His Word. This is the one that always makes me think a lot about it. It says, I thank God for the mountains. I thank Him for the valleys. I thank Him for the storms He brought me through. If I'd never had a problem, I wouldn't know that God could solve them. I've never known what faith in God could do. So when you have those problems, think about that. Jess is bringing something up.
I'm gonna
try. She's gonna play it for us.
I think I can.
It sounds like a rap song more than anything.
No,
when you're
it's very calm.
In a monotone voice.
If you ever listen to the Gaithers, a lot of times they sing it on the Gaithers.
I haven't heard of
that. What are you talking about right
now? It's a show. We had a show on you with us.
Yeah.
Like, how old is the show?
It's on now.
Oh, like it is?
Yeah, if you watch certain channels, it's in there.
It sounds like something like the Andy Griffith Show.
No, it's a Bill Gaither. Bill and Gloria Gaither have written a lot of hymns. And they have a thing going around. They call it... Bill and Gloria Gaither's Homecoming. I've been to two of them down at Target Center.
I was at one too, it's good.
What?
I was at one too, it's
were
good.
Were you? They are
what
good.
What if you guys were at
this
one at the same time?
I don't think. Stop. Not right yet.
Pinky should bring it up on the big screen.
Yeah, she could.
Pinky's
you got it on the big screen, Pinky?
What?
We're waiting for you to bring it up on the big screen.
What?
Through it all.
Come on, song.
Oh, yeah,
karaoke version so Craig can sing.
Yeah.
What?
Yes. Karaoke version. Craig needs it.
And so you can sing. Andrea
Croaky.
Oh, this might not be right either. We don't.
You don't want me to sing it.
Yeah,
yes, we do. We're literally like asking you to do it. You have a gift.
Craig, you're the best. Oh, you
I have a gift. My gift is announcement.
No, it's not. Your
gift is your iPhone.
There's the right version.
She's going to get right there. Right there.
The first one?
Yeah.
That guy. Ooh, can you put the rap version? I feel like it would be rap.
Enhance. Full screen. Full screen. Enhance. To me, and I don't know how I got here on the Indian night, but I'm here. So Lord kept talking to him, anything, and she's a press nine, and I was probably looking for, if I could just sing, and people would be so many miracles, how. And I thought I couldn't smile. Nor I things for tomorrow. There have been times when I didn't know right from wrong. But in every situation, God gave me blessed consolation. That all my trials come to only make me strong. And I've I've seen millions of faces, but there were times when I felt so all alone. But right there in the lonely hour, it became a precious lonely hour. But Jesus let me know that I was his own. Now I can say through it all, through it all, oh yes, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God through it all, through it all, oh yes, I've learned to depend upon his word. So now I thank God for the mountains, and I thank him for the valleys, and I thank him for the storms. He's brought me through. For if I'd never had a problem, I'd never know that God could solve them. I'd never know what faith in the word of God could do. Now I can tell the world that through it all, through it all, don't you know I've learned to trust in Jesus? I've learned to trust in God. Let me tell you that through it all, I've learned to depend upon his word. Every child of God here tonight, you want to thank God for every mountain. You should thank him for those valleys, or you should thank him for those storms, all that he's bringing you through right now. What would if you never have a problem? You never know that God can solve them. You never know what faith in the word of God can do. But you can stand like a soldier and say, through it all, or sometimes through the fire, but through it all, oh yes. Don't you know I've learned to trust in Jesus? I've learned to trust in God. Don't you know I've learned to depend upon his word? Through my sickness and pain, I've learned to depend upon his word. When the doctor walked from my bed and shook his head, where did I learn to depend upon his word?
Not my favorite version of that song, but it's
the piano was good.
I've never heard the first one before.
What's that?
We grew up just doing the chorus.
Yeah.
I've never heard the first one.
Okay. Oh, gosh. There's a few other people I like listening to better than, but that's the guy that wrote it.
It's gotta be
the
voice.
I just want you guys to know, especially you guys leaving and stuff like that, that we're always here.
Are you trying to make us cry, or what's the...
No.
He's like mentioning like four times.
I'm gonna be the one bawling in a couple weeks.
Oh, you better be.
We're gonna be watching the live stream, you better be crying.
But...
We should all get together and just watch it
together. Guys, I'll make sure. We're always here for you. Whether you're leaving or not, Jess, Tim, and I can always get a hold of us anytime. Any prayer requests for tonight? What do you want?
It's a wedding?
I wonder.
You sure you want me to pray for this wedding?
Yeah, better, I suppose. Might be the most stressful time of it all, you know?
Anybody else? Okay, let's pray, guys.
Girls, fight nice.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you again for this night. We thank you for each and every one who's here. We pray for those who couldn't be here. We pray for those who are sick. We pray for those that are close to passing tonight, Lord. We pray that you'll bless them and keep them and give them comfort, Lord. We pray that you'll just bless this wedding coming up in a little over a week. We pray that you'll be with Tatum and Cy and as they start their new life together, Lord. We thank you for them being with us, and we pray that you'll just be with them through everything they do. We thank you, Lord, for every one of our seniors that are leaving. We thank you for Brooke, that she's here tonight, Lord, and the rest of them that aren't. We thank you for giving us the years that they were here, Lord. We thank you for this place that we come in and we can enjoy being together, and we pray that you'll just bless everybody and keep everybody safe this next week, Lord. We can't wait to get back here and to have youth group again next week. We do all this in your name. Amen. Bye, Facebook.